All right, welcome back to Warrior Theology Podcast. I am your host, almost Dr. Peter Van Kleek, with my dad already, Dr. Peter Van Kleek. And we are in the second segment of our podcast for this week, and that is to offer an argument for a biblical sexual ethic based on a literal rendering of the Song of Solomon. And if you've been following us, we have now come to the eighth chapter. This very well may be our last episode as far as doing the overview of the book. We may do more, deeper dives into certain passages, do some more exegetical work for you, which I think would be great. And we also might, transition from this into wrestling with certain books that have to do with a sexual ethic, whether they be sexual or secular or they be Christian. And then we will match them, so to speak, against the Song of Solomon material we've been wrestling with in Scripture. So with that said, though, we're going to see if we can wrap up the end of chapter 8 here. So toss it over to you, Dad.
Well, we're going to try to wrap this up, verses 8 through 14. And what we have is the Shulamite speaking of siblings. And the siblings here, we believe are her brothers. This is in reference to her brothers, as we see it later in the text. And there's a concern here in regards to a little sister. The Shulamite has a little sister. And the way that she is described as having a younger sister is having like a child's body. It talks about her breasts being small, and there's a concern about her moral stability. I think it's important as we kind of tie this up that what we've seen throughout the psalm is there, or the song, there is a direct connection between the inward and outward beauty of the Shulamite. There is a connection made here. Talking about the spiritual and integrity of her heart, the true virtue of the Shulamite being reflected outwardly in her appearance. You can't separate the two. Inward and outward beauty are connected all the way through the song. And here it is again, her little sister is spoken of as having a child's body. And the Shulamite is spoken of as being beautiful it talks about she has breasts like towers, that you have a contrast here, all right, between the immature and the mature, all right, and it's described this way. The immature, that's one metaphor. The other metaphor here has to deal with a door, or a gate or a door. A door or a wall. I should have just looked at it here. A door is on hinges. It can swing open or close. A wall doesn't budge. All right. It's stable. And these metaphors are used in the sense of moral stability or moral integrity. And there's a concern here that the younger daughter, is compared to a wall. That is, compared to a door, they're not sure that she's going to withstand the pressures of life and maintain moral stability or moral integrity. And that's why she's described as a door that can open or close, all right? And within the context of this, the brothers are called upon to assist sort of as protectors of the younger sister, so she doesn't fall into some kind of transgression. On the other hand, you see the Shulamite, who it describes herself as a wall. That is, she is stable. That is, she has impeccable moral stability. She is mature. And so you see this contrast. And then it talks about this wall and then her breasts like towers. And the commentators talk about it's not just a wall, but it's a wall with towers, which accents further. It's the way in poetry that you would just further modify something already there. It's not just a castle with walls, I mean, described as far as who she is morally, but it's a castle with walls with high towers. I mean, it's formidable. It's something that cannot be overcome, overrun, and does not give ground. So you have the contrast here between the little sister described as a little child's body and the Shulamite, who is described as a mature woman body, the little the one sister is described as a door where you still got to keep an eye on her because we're not sure she can hold her ground if temptation comes. And you see the Shulamite, who is described not only as beautiful, but as a wall with towers, which further reinforces everything we've been seeing through the song about the godliness, the virtue, the impeccable integrity of the Shulamite. That has to be accented. I mean, all the way through it, when this is preached, I accented that, because when you come to the parts which speak of the more intimate things, this is an expression of godliness, nothing less. There's nothing inordinate or illicit about this. This is someone that has the moral stability described here as a wall with towers. So that would be the next section here in chapter 8, or as we come to a close. And then the last...
Wanted to point out that this is third, maybe fourth time that we've seen military-type language, yeah. Right? So we've talked about chariots, we've talked about towers before, and now we're wrestling or dealing with the idea of a wall and towers. This would be like battlements, right? So... and particularly when we're wrestling with concepts of moral righteousness or moral purity. And then, of course, from here, like, you can use this material now, like these ideas. And when we go to Ephesians chapter 6, and we talk about wrestling not against flesh and blood, we talk about the whole armor of God. And this is also kind of have this kind of militant type of language or military type of language, that this becomes part of that conversation as well. If you want to be or live a moral life, is the idea of being a wall with towers, right? You have not just the wall for defense, but you have the towers from which you can launch attacks, right? And of course, from the wall as well. So yeah, there is, and in this particular case, it's the woman speaking of herself in this way. She recognizes her formidable nature. She recognizes her kind of moral standing, right? And versus of course, her younger sister, who, as Dad said, we're not entirely sure that they're as confident in her moral standing or her capacity for fortitude. So,
which it brings us down to verse 10. From 10 to the end, from 10 to 14, it's just a combination of all kinds of things. How much property they own, the acreage, so to speak, how large it is, the wealth that can be garnered from it, how many servants they have working it. It is an idyllic picture of prosperity. It talks about Solomon having his vineyard. It talks about the Shulamite having her vineyard, that these vineyards are combined, that she considers her vineyard his vineyard. It is a, in verse 12, it talks about her vineyard is added to Solomon's, not only to gather the 1,000 shekels, but in the bounty to those that work in the fields, 200 shekels. It's all of this. You say to yourself, I mean, when you read it all, you say it looks like a bunch of farm accounting for farming between the Shulamite and Solomon. The point of this, I believe, is that what we're seeing here at the end of the song is a picture of complete fulfillment in life, of success and satisfaction and cooperation, working the fields together, a mature uniting of one's life in these common goals. The importance, in verse 10, it says, then was I as in his eyes as one that found favor. I mean, we're right at the end that she finds favor in his eyes. The idea here of favor is the word shalom or peace. Isn't that wonderful? The important characteristic of finding God's choice for your husband and wife is found in the word shalom, where you get peace or safety, well-being or happiness. That's what this is all about. Listen, I mean, I just heard some distressing news about someone I know, and And these ladies, there's ladies that think that their husbands should be like science projects. Maybe they're going to save them, you know. These men do not bring peace. What she finds here in her union with Solomon after all of this is peace. When you come home, there's peace between me and Solomon. I bring him peace. She gives me peace. A friendliness, favor, fulfillment, contentment, satisfaction. That's what all of this is about. It's all captured in that great Hebrew word, shalom. And then I just asked the question, are these feelings and answers you give after reasonably consider characteristics of a person you might marry? If you marry this person, and we're not talking there's not ups and downs, because there is, but is substantially in this person a character of peace? I mean, your house is going to be a place of peace, and that's where this ends up. And then there's all this picture of working in the vineyard. In verse 13, Solomon speaks, calling for the Shulamite who's in the garden. Others are listening to the voice of his beloved. Solomon wants to hear her. And then in verse 14, to this the woman responds in a hurried way. It's interesting here. It's illustrative again of chapter 2 when you got the roe and the young hart. I mean, we're right at the end of the song. They're married, and now they're rushing to see one another. Pictures of strength, youth, and vitality. See, this is what you get at the end of the song. You get something that makes you alive. Your vitality fills you. Life fills you. A blessing fills you. Peace fills you. There's really not enough. I mean, we could add all these adjectives together, but what it says is at the end of this is a absolutely, completely fulfilled, satisfied life. That's what you get here at the end of the song. And she wants him to bound over all obstacles between them and to be together. And then it ends right there. And you say, well, that what kind of ending is that? Because it doesn't, there's no prologue. It ends in this vineyard. We're coming together. I love her. He loves me. And Tremper Longman, a professor I had at Westminster, I think I only had him for one class, but wrote a commentary on the Song of Songs, concludes this. And this is a quote from Longman in his book. His literary expression thus matches love itself. Never satisfied with enough, but longing for more. Because when you get done reading with that, you think there should be at least another season of the Song of Songs. I mean, it looks like this is going to propel you into another stage of life. Like, what's that like? Another commentator said, and I find so real worth in this, that the song, because of this is a song about love, true godly marital love, that this abrupt ending points you back to verse 1 of chapter 1. That this isn't something that's linear as much as it is, this is the way the married couples live their lives. This is how it works. It's not like, well, once this is done, it's over, and now we're on to this. No, that when you get done reading the song, like every other book of the Bible, you're not done reading it. Not if you're truly a student of the word. You're going to go back again and read it. You're going to go back again, like you should do all the books of the Bible. Go back again. But Longman makes the point that it ends abruptly, because love is about the most irregular, surprising, unexpected, incalculable thing that we experience. It rises and falls. I mean, it's marvelous. It changes. And so he says, love, never, you're never satisfied enough with it, but you're always longing for more. And that's where it ends. So
yeah. So a couple things when it comes to them talking about their vineyards. Oh, well, no, I wanted to make a mention on 9. When it says with regard to the younger sister, if she be a wall, we will build upon her a palace of silver. If she be a door, we will enclose her with boards of cedar. One thing that we see, and we've seen this throughout the song as well, is that the family is very much involved in the care, and they should be involved in the care and approval and things like that, particularly before marriage and then here with this younger sister. But it is the brothers who serve as an instrument of protection for their potential, or for their sister who may need some help, I guess you'd say, staying on the tracks. So you have that. The idea of their vineyards, certainly if it's set me as a seal upon thine heart, as a seal upon thine arm, then it would make sense that your property is one as well. And think about that, to be married to the king, particularly that your property becomes one, you know? So if you're one body, if you're one in soul, then the things that you have are manifestations of who you are and the life that you spent achieving them. So they end up being one. And then, yeah, it does end in verse 14, make haste, my beloved, and be thou like a roe or to a young hart upon the mountains of spices. We've seen this over and over. This is the language the Shulamite particularly speaks of Solomon. I very much appreciate the idea of it taking us back to earlier portions of the song. That's not really an end. It's this refrain that we've seen at least a couple, maybe three other times in the song, that maybe it just needs to take us back to those very same things when he, you know, after the spring, he comes and sees her and he's looking through the lattice. And when it says that he feedeth among the lilies, that he's this, you know, like, so it takes us back to those instances, thus giving us this idea that love isn't like this linear thing. It's a very involved and constant, it's alive, right? Think of it in those terms, it's alive. So yes, indeed, very powerful. But that takes us to the end through verse 14 of chapter 8, and that's it. Are there any closing remarks, Dad, that you'd like to make in the, I don't know, 9 or so minutes we have left? Anything that you'd want to draw to people's attention or I don't know, maybe the stuff that you thought was perhaps most poignant? I know you were preaching it, so there's those elements, but or maybe something that our culture needs that's missing, our church culture or society.
Well, I mean, I said this at the front of this. I mean, I don't know how many weeks ago, but all the Bible was meant to be preached. I think if I could say anything over about the song, that would be it. All the Bible was meant to be preached. If all the Bible was not meant to be preached, then, and this is the exception, and here's what I've heard. Oh, well, the rabbi said that you shouldn't read this until you're 30 years old. I just want you to know who were always antagonistic to the Lord. It was mainstream Hebraism. That tradition should not have any impact on a New Testament believer who's being led by the Spirit to read the Word of God, some rabbinical tradition. That tradition burdened their folks with laws and regulations that they themselves did not follow. So you just have to lay aside all this and place the song in the canon with everything else. And then the next thing is, for all of the, I'm a Baptist. I'm not Reformed. I mean, I'm a soteriological Calvinist, but I'm not Reformed. I believe that the church started in Acts chapter 2 and that the church did not exist in the Old Testament. That's what I'm trying to say. The church starts in Acts 2. Salvation is consistent through both Testaments, but the church is not in the Old Testament. God's dealing with Israel. I make a distinction between Israel and the church and the way God deals with things. So when you come to the song, there's no way when Solomon wrote that he could be thinking of Christ and the church, because until the Apostle Paul opens the floodgates, I mean, up until this time, there's still a struggle in the first century about the role of the Old Testament and the law in this new thing called Christianity. I mean, you have the Jerusalem Council, you have the confrontation with Peter in Galatians. I mean, Peter has to see the sheet come down out of heaven, and the Lord's got to tell him, no, don't say what's unclean that I call clean. this transition in the first century between the Old and the New Testament was hard on these guys. And I don't ever say that critically, because if we were back then, we'd be fighting through it as well. But the fact is, when that was written in, Solomon could not have meant that or allegorized this to mean the church. This had to be something imposed either by the Reformed tradition, imposed by Roman Catholicism, but did not come out of the New Testament. I mean, from those that identify a separation between Israel and the church. And why guys of my stripe do that? I mean, I'd like to ask them all. It's like they bought into the Reform idea and applied it to the song, and therefore we have this allegorizing of it. Plus, there's not another book in the Bible that our tradition, we take all this heat from the Reform guys because we use this word literal, and that's taken to pieces. We believe in a literal interpretation. Until you come to this, we believe in a literal interpretation unless there's some grammatical indicator to tell us it should be read in another way, or some convention that tells us, like in, what is it, Galatians 4, where we actually have an allegory. It says it's an allegory. So when we read this, to say that it is not to be read literally, I mean, I think is a jump for guys of our tradition. The Baptist guys, the Bible guys, the Bible church, Baptist church guys should be the ones that are wholeheartedly on board for a literal rendering of this. Everything else we read literally, except here, it's like we adopt either a Roman Catholic or a Reformed rendering of this. And it's all, we allegorize it all away. And even some of our Baptist forefathers, I think of John Gill, if you've ever read his stuff, and everybody likes Gill, until you read him on the song, he makes everything into something else until you hardly recognize what you're reading. I said, hey, I'm going to use Gill in my paper until you start reading them. And then he makes everything into something else, which is Gill's idea. I could have my commentary. I can make all these words into something else. Or you, the watching, if you allegorize it, you can make all these words into something else, so they say something else. As Orthodox or unorthodox or Christocentric or less Christocentric or old covenant or less old covenant, if you don't stay with the words, then you'll never know. And that's why one of the guys I quoted, and his name just slips my mind, he said that there was a prejudice, there's a historic prejudice against the Song of Solomon. And a prejudice is an unfounded opposition to it, not rational. There's another reason. And he was convinced that the reason there was opposition to it is simply because of its content. And that's, and even after, if you watch all these videos, we're not talking about this thing, the song being filled full of intimacy. It's a book of romance that includes intimacy, which is an important part of romance in a strong Christian marriage. But when every verse you turn over, you're not finding illicit act, or you're not finding full marital oneness within the bounds of matrimony. There, it is in there, but it's all part of a greater argument for romance. So I guess, if I were to summarize all that, all I would say is that if there was ever a time where we needed to teach a Christian sexual ethic against the onslaught that is against everything good and right in the world, where we're determining whether or not you're a boy or a girl by what you consider yourself, where girls are being ostracized from girls' sports because now boys are allowed to participate in women's sports, when we have all these different layers of genders, which is absurd, when we have homosexuality, it's pretty well accepted, but not consistent with the Bible. It's contrary to Scripture. All these things, pornography, the idea that that you could just live with somebody and sleep with somebody before you're married is almost just taken for granted now. None of these things will bring the wholesome satisfaction. What, especially I'm thinking of the ladies. let me say one other thing. I mentioned about the ladies, because you know here that the only ones that had to be careful about being a wall or a door were the ladies, because the men in that portion will be the aggressors. There's no, they're going to be on their way. And so as a lady, you're either going to be a door or a wall, because they are coming. And that coming does not mean it's going to be right. If you're a lady that's described as a door, and the aggressor, which is the man, come, they will compromise you, or you'll compromise yourself. But if you as a lady are a wall when that comes, you'll be able to fend off that kind of attack. So we are up to our necks in trouble. I don't need to say that. If you just look around, and there's one book of the Bible that deals with establishing Christian homes, and this is it. And the guys in the pulpit, and I understand everybody's really under the gun, but this is the one they ought to teach. If you don't want to preach it from the pulpit, do it in an adult Sunday school class, or do it for your young married couples, but get it rolling along. Just start it if you don't want to do it right from the pulpit for the whole congregation. But that's, I guess, if I could just encapsulate all of that. The church needs to hear this. So I don't know, son.
That's good. I just want to make one comment, and that is we are reminded in Ephesians that marriage is a mystery. It is in relation to Christ and the church, and that is a mystery, how we are one. And I think that if God has given us a whole book of the Bible to consider, then and it's already a deep thing, marriage is, then why would we not pay particular attention to an entire book that seems to address the topic? So, all right, that gets us to the end of kind of our somewhat helicopter view of Song of Solomon. As I said, we're going to kind of decide the trajectory from here on out, whether we want to deal with commentaries or other books on the topic of marriage, or if we're going to do some deeper exegetical work in the book itself to really kind of develop some of these things further. Either way, if you want, you know, a particular direction, if there's a book you'd like us to look at, go ahead and visit us at wisdomgap.org. And there is a form up there. You can just put in the question, your contact information, and we'll take that into account when we press on. If you haven't subscribed to the channel, by all means, please subscribe, share the material as you're able. And then, of course, if you would like to hang out with us, talk. I mean, nowadays, it almost seems like we don't have very much human-to-human interaction. So if you want to do Zoom, we can do Zoom. If you'd like to meet over a cup of coffee, we are there. And if you want us to come to your church or to your small group or something, we'd love to do that as well. So we'll put that out to you, just our availability, right? We want to be faithful and available to do the Lord's work as long as he gives us life and breath. So those things. It's good to see everybody. Thanks for being with us this week, and we'll see y'all later.